Be informed. SMS your name to 0406 000 UMA.
الحمد لله رب العالمين ولي الصالحين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له إله الأولين والآخرين وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله نبي شرح الله له صدره ووضع عنه وزره ورفع له ذكره فصلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وعلى أصحابه الغر الميامين وعلى التابعين وأتباع التابعين اللهم وعنا معهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. We continue with our series about أمهات المؤمنين, the mothers of the believers. And by talking about أمهات المؤمنين, we show the great status of women in Islam. And we respond to any call by the enemies of Islam, any accusation, when they accuse Islam of a religion that is depriving and oppressing women, we talk about the mothers of the believers, and we take them as role models, as people that we look up to, and people that we respect. It's enough to know that in Islam, there's a surah called Surah An-Nisa, and there's another surah named after a woman, Surah Maryam. And it's enough to know that the first person in Islam to prostrate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a woman, Khadija radiallahu anha. And the first person from this ummah to be guaranteed paradise after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a woman. And the first shaheed in this ummah was a woman. So we show everyone that we have great role models in Islam that we look up to and we respect, which are the mothers of the believers and all the righteous women that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had mentioned in the Quran, and all the righteous and pious women that have been mentioned in the history. However, Ummahatul Mu'mineen, the mothers of the believers, the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they have special status in Islam, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "An-nabiyyu awla bil mu'minina min anfusihim wa azwajuhu ummahatun lahum." And tonight, we'll be talking about As-Sawwama, Al-Qawwama, the one who used to fast a lot, and the one who used to pray a lot, Hafsa bint Umar ibn al-Khattab, the wife or the daughter of the second Khalifa, the daughter of the second greatest man in Islam, the second greatest companion after Abu Bakr, the daughter of Umar radiallahu anh. And again, the name speaks for itself. Her mother is Zainab bint Mad'un, the sister of the great companion Uthman ibn Mad'un. So the great companion Uthman ibn Mad'un, he is the uncle of Hafsa radiallahu anha. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about Uthman bin Mad'un and his family, رحمكم الله آل مضعون قد كنتم بيتا تقيا. And Uthman bin Mad'un radiallahu anha, the uncle of Hafsa, he has a great history in Islam. At the early stages of Islam, at the early stages in Mecca, when the Muslims were being oppressed, when the Muslims were facing hardships, when the Muslims were being tortured, at that stage, in the early stages of Islam, Uthman bin Mad'un radiallahu anhu was a respected man in Mecca, a respected man in Quraysh. And he had a friend before Islam. His name was Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira. And Walid ibn al-Mughira did not want to see his friend Uthman bin Mad'un being oppressed and tortured. So he went to Uthman ibn Mad'un and told him, Ya Uthman, a'taytuka jiwari, I'll give you my jiwar. And jiwar is a word that the Arabs used to use. Means, I gave you my protection. So if you tell someone, I've given you my jiwar, that means I've given you my protection and no one can come near you. So they used to honor the words. So Uthman bin Mad'un was under the protection of Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira. Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira was a kafir. So Uthman bin Mad'un radiallahu anhu, he used to look at the Muslims in Mecca. He used to look at the companions. He used to look at Bilal and Khabbab. And he used to look at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he used to see the hardships they used to face and the torture they used to go through. So Uthman bin Mad'un radiallahu anhu said, by Allah, I want to face whatever the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is facing, and I want to face what the other believers are facing. So Uthman bin Mad'un went to Al-Walid al-Mughira and he said to him, Ya Walid, anta fi hillin min jiwari. Khala'tu jiwarak. Ya Walid, I do not want your protection. I do not need your protection anymore. So Al-Walid al-Mughira, as an Arab man, he said to Uthman, did you find someone stronger than me? Did you find someone who can give you better protection than me? Uthman bin Mad'un said, I have left your protection and only seeking the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Al-Walid al-Mughira warned Uthman bin Mad'un. He said to him, Ya Uthman, if you leave my protection, if you do not want my protection, you will be attacked, you will be tortured. So Uthman bin Mad'un said, I do not want your protection and I only want the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Uthman bin Mad'un, he went looking for the people of Mecca, the people, the leaders of Quraysh, to tell them that he is not under the protection of Al-Walid al-Mughira and they can do whatever they want because he wanted to face what the other believers were facing. So Uthman bin Mad'un, he went to Al-Ka'bah and he found the leaders of Quraysh all gathered around one man by the name of Labid bin Rabi'a. And Labid bin Rabi'a was one of the most famous Arab poets. He wrote 7 poems called Al-Mu'allaqat. They were written with gold and they were displayed in the Kaaba. Because we all know that the Arabs before Islam, they were very, very eloquent in the Arabic language and they were very fluent. So they went and all the leaders of Quraysh were sitting around Labid bin Rabi'a. And before we continue with the story of Uthman, I just have to mention something about Labid bin Rabi'a. Labid bin Rabi'a, he became a Muslim. He accepted Islam at a later stage in his life. He accepted Islam. However, Labid bin Rabi'a, during the Battle of Al-Qadisiyyah, at the time of Umar radiallahu anhu, Labid was Muslim at that stage. Umar radiallahu anhu, he wrote to Labid and he said to him, write a poem to motivate the army so we can motivate people to go and fight. So Labid bin Rabi'a wrote Surah Al-Baqarah and he sent it to Umar. So Umar wrote back to Rabi'a and he said, we all know Surah Al-Baqarah. I asked you to write a poem. So Labid said to Umar, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, Askat al-Qur'an kulla sha'ir. The eloquence and the strength of the Qur'an has silenced every poet. And that shows the strength of the Qur'an. Ahal Labid himself was a poet and he was very eloquent in the Arabic language, but when he read the Quran he admitted that the eloquency of the Quran defeats the eloquency of all the Arabs, and that by itself shows the miracle of the Quran. So Uthman bin Mad'un was sitting with the other people around Labid bin Rabi'a. Then Labid, he said, Ala kullu shay'in ma khala Allah batilu. Everything other than the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is falsehood. So Uthman bin Mad'un said to him, Sadaqt, true. Then Labid said, وَكُلُّ نَعِيمٍ لَا مَحَالَةَ زَائِلُ. And every luxury will vanish, will end. So Uthman bin Mad'un said, كَذَبْت. You have lied, you're not right. The luxury of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not vanish, does not end. So Labid bin Rabi'a said to the leaders of Quraysh, How can you allow Uthman bin Mad'un, how can you allow that man speak to me like that? They said, he is under the protection of Al-Walid ibn Mughira. So at that stage, Uthman bin Mad'un said, no, I am not under the protection of Al-Walid ibn Mughira anymore. So they all stood up and they attacked him, the moment they were waiting for. So they kept on hitting him and until they hurt one of his eyes. And then they left him. So Al-Walid ibn Mughira came to Uthman bin Mad'un and told him, Ya Uthman, wasn't it better for you if you have stayed under my protection? Look what happened to your eye. He said, by Allah, my other eye is willing to face the same thing that my other eye faced for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My other eye hasn't got hurt yet, is willing to get hurt for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. the same way my other eye got hurt. So Hafsa radiallahu anha came from that household. Her father is Umar radiallahu anha. Her mother is Zainab bint Mad'un. Her uncle from her father's side is Zayd bin Khattab, a companion that witnessed Badr and Uhud, from the first people that accepted Islam. Her uncle is Uthman bin Mad'un and the family of Mad'un. They're all from the first people that entered Islam. Her brother is Abdullah ibn Umar, the righteous companion, the pious man, that no one was known to be a follower of the Sunnah, a follower of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam like him. So she came from that environment, and then that character got later on perfected when she got married to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Hafsa radiallahu anha, she was born in the fifth year of Ba'tha, or 5 years before the Ba'tha of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, 5 years before the message. And she was married before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam got married to her, she was a widow. Hafsa radiallahu anha got married for the first time at the age of 12. So that also shows that women at that time, they used to get married early, at an early stage. And we mentioned last week how Aisha radiallahu anha got married to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam at the age of 9, because it was normal for women at that age to get married early at that age. And also that proves when we say that Hafsa radiallahu anha got married to her first husband and she was only 12. Her first husband was Khunais ibn Hudhafa al-Sahmi. And that name rings the bell. He is the brother of the great companion, Abdullah ibn Hudhafa al-Sahmi, who has a great story with one of the kings of the Romans that showed the greatness of Islam. Inshallah, one day we'll mention the story of Abdullah ibn Hudhafa. So Hafsa radiallahu anha was married to Khunais ibn Hudhafa al-Sahmi. And they have migrated together for the first time to Al-Habasha, to Abyssinia. Then they returned back to Mecca when there was some rumors that the leaders of Quraysh were accepting Islam. And then they migrated together to Medina. Khunais radiallahu anha, he was one of the companions that witnessed the battle of Badr. And he also witnessed the battle of Uhud with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we see that the whole family of Hafsa radiallahu anha were from the people of Badr. And the best of the ummah, the best of the companions, are the ones that witnessed the battle of Badr with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Umar one day, Ya Umar, وما يدريك يا عمر هون يذا لعل الله اطلع على أهل بدر فقال اصنعوا ما شئتم قد غفرت لكم يا عمر how would you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the people of Badr, do whatever you want, I have forgiven you, because the battle of Badr showed who are the true believers. Khunais ibn Hudhafa radiallahu an, he was from those companions that defended the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the battle of Uhud, and he showed his great love to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when the Prophet was on the mountain of Uhud and the kuffar of Quraysh were trying to get to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to kill the Prophet, and the companions were throwing their bodies in front of the body of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, shielding the Prophet, protecting the Prophet. Khunais ibn Hudhafa was one of those that got wounded and injured in the battle of Uhud, defending our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he did not die in the battle of Uhud straight away, but he died later on because of his wounds. So Hafsa at that time, she was a widow, and she became a widow at the age of 21. So Umar radiallahu anhu was so concerned about his daughter. She's still young and she's a widow at that age. So he decided to look for a good husband for his daughter. And subhanAllah, that is the sunnah. That is the sunnah, that if you have a daughter, try to find her a good husband. Try to find her a righteous husband. So Abu Bakr Umar radiallahu anhu, he went and he wanted a pious man for his daughter. So he approached his companion, his friend, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Said, Ya Abu Bakr, I am offering to you, I'm offering you to marry my daughter Hafsa. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu did not give an answer to Umar radiallahu anhu. So Umar sensed that Abu Bakr is not interested in marrying Hafsa, in getting married to Hafsa. So Umar went and he spoke to Uthman radiallahu anhu. And he spoke and he approached Uthman and he told him, I'm offering you to get married to my daughter Hafsa. So Uthman radiallahu anhu, he said to Umar at that stage, I will get back to you. I will respond to you soon. So time went past and Uthman radiallahu anhu did not respond to Umar. So Umar went looking for him and he found him in the masjid praying. So when Uthman sensed that Umar was right next to him, he prolonged his prayer. He did not want to finish his prayer. It was an embarrassing moment for him. So when Uthman finished, Umar approached me. He said, I'm still waiting for your answer. Uthman at that stage, he said, I do not have any interest in getting married at this stage. So Umar radiallahu anh was very upset. He approaches Abu Bakr and he does not respond to him. Then he approaches Uthman and at the beginning he tells him, I will respond back to you. Then when he does not respond to him, he tells him, he goes and he looks for him and he tells him, I have no interest in getting married at this time. So he decided to go and speak to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to complain about what happened between him and Umar, between him and Abu Bakr and Uthman. So he went, Ya Rasulullah, he said, Ya Rasulullah, I have approached our companions, your companions and my companions, Abu Bakr and Uthman, and I have offered them to marry my daughter Hafsa. Abu Bakr did not respond to me, and Uthman told me he will think about it. And then when he did not get back to me, I went looking for him, and he told me that he is not interested in getting married. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told Umar, said, Ya Umar, يتزوج حفصة من هو خير من أبي بكر وعثمان. Someone better than Abu Bakr and Uthman will marry Hafsa. ويتزوج عثمان من هي خير من حفصة. And Uthman will get married to someone who is better than Hafsa. So Umar was amazed. What's this? Someone better than Abu Bakr and Umar will get married to, better than Abu Bakr and Uthman will get married to my daughter Hafsa. Who else is left? Except that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And who else is better than Hafsa that Uthman will get married to? So Umar straight away, Umar is a very smart and intelligent man. He understood, but he wanted a clear answer from the Prophet ﷺ. You know when someone gives you an indication about something, but you get so excited, you're so happy, and you stay on his back because you want to hear straight answer. You want to hear straight away. You don't just hear indications, you want to hear the straight answer. So the Prophet ﷺ told him, I will marry Hafsa, and Uthman will marry my daughter Umm Kulthum. And one of the reasons that Uthman radiallahu anhu, he did not want to get married at that stage, because his wife Ruqayya, which is the daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, had just passed away, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted him to marry his other daughter Umm Kulthum. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he left the masjid and he was very happy with a big smile on his face. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, saw him outside the masjid and he approached him. And he knew that the Prophet ﷺ had told him that he wants to marry Hafsa. So he said, Ya Umar, maybe you got upset with me when I did not respond to you about marrying your daughter. He said, yes, I got upset with you. He said, by Allah, I did not respond to you because the Prophet ﷺ had already indicated in front of me that he is interested in getting married to Hafsa. And I could not say anything because the Prophet ﷺ wanted to keep it as a secret at that stage. And I was not the person to expose the secret of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam until the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam wanted to approach you and tell you that he is interested in marrying Hafsa. The same incident also happened with Uthman. And Uthman told Umar one of the reasons that he did not respond to him because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had already approached him about marrying his other daughter, and the Prophet already told him that he is interested in marrying Hafsa, the daughter of Umar. But let's look at Abu Bakr here. And let's look at the sincerity of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam approached him and told him, indicated to him that he is interested in marrying Hafsa. And then Umar radiallahu anhu comes to him and he proposes to Umar, or offers Abu Bakr to marry Hafsa, his daughter. Abu Bakr at that stage, he is faced in a situation where his best friend is telling him, his best friend who is married to his daughter, the Prophet ﷺ is married to Aisha, the daughter of Abu Bakr. The Prophet is telling him that he wants to marry another wife. And then Umar approaches the Prophet and tells him, or Umar approaches Abu Bakr and he tells him, or offers him to marry Hafsa. Umar, someone other than Abu Bakr would have said, look at this man, he wants to marry someone else other than my daughter. He's already married to my daughter and he wants to get another wife. He wants to marry on my daughter. And then how about I just go and marry this girl to stop that man from marrying another woman on my daughter? But that's not how the Sahaba used to think. They had sincerity. The Prophet would consult in his friend, who wasn't only his friend, but who was he? In today's terms, he was his hammer, his father-in-law. He would consult in his best friend, his father-in-law, to tell him that he's interested also in marrying another woman. That is the top of relationship that Sahaba radiallahu anhum had. When the Prophet would approach Abu Bakr and tell him, "Yeah, Abu Bakr, I'm interested in marrying Hafsa, and I'm already married to your daughter Aisha," the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, or Abu Bakr radiallahu anh, would not turn away from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but he also will get happy for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. That's how the companions radiallahu anhum used to think. That is the relationship that used to take place. That is the relationship that used to take place between, as in today's terms, a father-in-law and son-in-law. Now, who has that relationship today with his father-in-law? Who can consult in him and tell him about his own secrets? Don't tell him you want to marry another woman, because that will never happen. He's not going to take it. But at least consult and talk to him about some of your private stuff. Who has that relationship? We want that relationship. We want the fathers today to go and look for the righteous man, for the good man, for their daughters. Umar radiallahu anh implemented what was in the Quran. When Shu'aib alayhi salatu wasalam approaches who? Approaches Musa alayhi salam, and he says to him, "Inni uridu an unkihaka ihda ibnatay." I want you to marry one of my daughters. Inni uridu an unkihaka ihda ibnatay hatain. I want to marry you off to one of my daughters. I have two daughters, and I want you to marry one of them. And before that, the daughter of Shu'aib, what did she say to her father? Ya abati istajirh, inna khayra man istajarta al-qawiyya al-amin. Oh my father, hire him, referring to Musa. Oh my father, hire him. The best you can hire is the one who is strong and trustworthy. Now, how did the daughter of Shu'aib know that Musa, alayhi salatu wasalam, was strong and trustworthy? Of course, she knew he was strong when she saw him lifting the big rock to remove it so they can drink, and so can so they can fill water for their cattle, and they can fill water for themselves. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was carrying a big hard rock. But she knew that he's the Amin, he's the trustworthy, he's the honest one. When Musa alayhi salatu wasalam did not even look at them, he only spoke to them briefly. He did not give them any weird looks. He did not create conversations with them out of nowhere. And that's another story, inshallah, one day we will speak about. But Musa did not want to just create any conversation. He was very brief, wanted just to help the women and leave. So that's a message for our sisters. Do not trust any man who wants to have a long conversation with you, any stranger who wants to chat you up, who wants to have a long conversation with you. The honest man who will have haya, and if he does not have a reason to speak to you, he will not speak to you. If there's nothing necessary to speak about, he'll not speak to you. But subhanAllah, today we say it's spreading. Women speaking to men who are stranger to them. He's my colleague at uni, and he's my colleague at work, and he's our next door neighbor, and he's my sister's wife, second cousin, whatever. And they find reason to speak. A stranger is a stranger. If there's no reason to speak to the stranger, do not speak. And if you speak, keep it minimum. Keep it minimum. Whether it's for boys, for males and females, do not speak to females and do not speak to males. Do not speak to the opposite gender unless it is necessary for you. So when the daughter of Musa, when the daughter of Shu'aib approached her father to hire Musa, Shu'aib, alayhi salam, he said, "Inni uridu an unkihaka ihda ibnatayya hatain," because he knew that Musa was trustworthy. And that's what Umar radiallahu anhu did exactly. He wanted to follow us in the Quran. He was looking for the pious man for his daughter. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said in the hadith, "In atakum man tardawna deenahu wa khuluqahu fazawwijuhu illa taf'alu takun fitnatun fil ardi wa fasadun kabir." If someone comes to you offering to marry your daughter and you accept his religion and you accept his manners, marry him off. If you do not do such, you will cause a big fitna and big corruption. Because what happened? People these days, they look for what? They look for the one with the money, they look for position, and the last thing they look for is what? Is wealth. And one day one of my friends was talking about a similar topic, and was actually giving a khutbah. And he was saying that people should marry their daughters off to the one who is pious. So someone stood up in the khutbah and said, "Please find the sheikh a wife." He thought the sheikh is just giving that khutbah so he can what? He is looking for himself. So I told him, "Ya akhi, wallahi, I'm married, but I want to help my Muslim brothers." So that's something we should consider. Look for someone who is pious. Not look for position, not look for wealth, not look for the degree. Of course, you want someone to look after your daughter. But if you want someone to look after you, if he has the deen, everything will come after that. Hafsa radiallahu anha was known to be as-sawwama al-qawwama, the one who used to fast a lot and the one used to pray a lot. And that's why an incident happened during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam when he was married to Hafsa. That when the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam were requesting the Prophet to increase from the nafaqah, from spending on them, and the Prophet was very upset with their wives, the narrator said that Hafsa was actually divorced. The Prophet divorced her one. And At-Tabarani narrates that Jibreel came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and said, return Hafsa. Jibreel comes to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and says, return Hafsa. Ra'fatan bi'umar. Return Hafsa because of her father. And another narration says, return Hafsa. إنها صوامة قوام. Return Hafsa. She fasts a lot and she prays a lot. And from this story we learn that in every household there are problems. But how do we approach those problems? We mention the stories not because we want people to say the wives of the Prophet were bad, the wives of the Prophet ﷺ were the best of women. But in every household there's problems. But how do we approach those problems? And also, when Jibreel comes to the Prophet ﷺ and says to him, إِنَّهَا صَوَّامَةٌ قَوَّامَةٌ, that means if you see something you don't like in your wife, look at something you like. And if a sister sees something she doesn't like about her husband, look at something you like. His faults are only 1% comparing to his good. And same thing, if your wife has faults, her faults are only 1% comparing to her good. And that's why Jibreel alayhi salam comes from the heaven to tell the Prophet ﷺ that Allah is ordering him to return Hafsa because what? Because she's a person that she used to fast. She fasts and prays a lot. When Hafsa radiallahu anha got married to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Umar radiallahu anha gave his daughter the right advice that every father should give his daughter. Hafsa radiallahu anha was a jealous woman. And of course, all the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam were jealous over him. And if someone wants to be jealous over the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam were jealous over him because he is the Prophet and he was their husband. But we also should be jealous when we see someone practicing the sunnah more than us. I should be jealous from someone, if really I should be jealous only from a person that is closer to Allah, closer to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, closer to the sunnah, applies the sunnah in his life more than me. That's when I should be jealous. So Abu Bakr, Umar radiallahu anhu, approaches Hafsa and he says, Ya bunayyati, ya madura, you are a jealous woman, so control your jealousy from now. And do not let your jealousy destroy your relationship with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And do not compete with Aisha at all, because she is more beloved to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam than you, and her father is more beloved to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam than your father. So Umar is admitting himself that Abu Bakr is closer to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and more beloved to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam than him. And who is Umar? He is the second greatest companion after Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. So do not let your jealousy destroy your life. And do not let the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam be upset with you. Because if the Prophet is upset with you, he will leave you. And he will be upset with me. And you will cause a big problem for your family. A problem that we cannot avoid and we cannot face. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he wanted to protect that relationship he had with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He's already his companion. Well, he's even happier when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam got married to his daughter. Now look at the advice that Umar radiallahu anhu gave his daughter. And that's the advice every parent, all parents should give to their sons and daughters. Today what happens? The family of the man that tell him, smash your wife from the start. And do not give her any freedom. And do not trust her. And women cannot be treated kindly. And be mean. And then on the other hand, on the other side, the family of the woman. Destroy your husband. Make sure he's always tired. He's busy. Do not leave $1 in his pocket. He's going to get married to another woman. That's not what we want. We build the house on what? The Muslim household from the beginning on what? On hatred, on lack of trust. That's not what we want. We want to build it on trust. It's a household, it's a Muslim household, it's a fortress, it's something sacred. That Muslim house is a rock within the ummah, within the structure of the ummah. If that rock is solid, the whole ummah will be solid, and that's what we want. So Umar radiallahu anhu gave his daughter the right advice that every father, every parent should give their son or daughter when they get married. Now Hafsa and Aisha radiallahu anhuma were close friends before even the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam got married to Hafsa. So look at this now. Abu Bakr and Umar are the closest companion to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and their daughters are friends. And then later on, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam gets married to Hafsa, and that friendship becomes what? A lot of people will say becomes weaker because they're both married to the same man. No, became even stronger. And for a fact, the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam were divided into two teams. One team was Hafsa, Aisha radiallahu anha, and with them was Sauda bint Zama'a. On the other hand, the other team was Zainab bint Jahsh, Umm Salama, and the rest of the wives. And of course, there used to always be competition between Hafsa, between Aisha and Zainab, because of their beauty and because of their relationship to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So Hafsa would always take the side of Aisha, her friend. And one day they knew that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, always before he comes to one of their houses, before he comes to the house either of Hafsa and Aisha, and by the way, the house of Hafsa and Aisha, or the hujra of Hafsa and Aisha, were facing each other, right in front of each other. So that shows how close they were. And they used to speak to each other a lot, of course. They knew that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, before he comes to either of them, he would always go past his other wife, Zainab bint Jahsh, who was the one that Aisha said, I knew she's the only one that would be competing with me. And the Prophet used to go to Zainab's house and eat honey. He got to Zainab's house and ate honey. So they decided to do a trick on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They said to each other, if the Prophet comes to you, tell him you smell like maghafir. Maghafir is kind of plant that the Arabs used to eat at that time, and it has a smell. So they said to each other, when the Prophet comes to your house, tell him you smell like maghafir, like that plant. And we're going to say the same thing to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he went to Aisha's house, and she told him that. And then he went to the Prophet's, he went to Hafsa's house, and she told him, you smell like maghafir. The Prophet ﷺ said, I did not eat maghafir, I ate asal. So what did Hafsa say? Then maybe you ate honey, and the bee that collected that honey was in a place where there was maghafir. Subhanallah. So the Prophet ﷺ understood what they were referring to. He said, okay, I will not eat honey after today. So that shows how the Prophet ﷺ wanted to contain the problem. He did not say, look, I'm going to eat honey, and do whatever you want, and if you don't like it, just go and do whatever you want. He just wanted to contain the problem in a smart way. Why should I create a bigger problem when I can contain it? Why should I get stubborn about it? The Prophet ﷺ didn't say, I'm not going to go to Zainab, but he said, I'm not going to eat honey there. And that's it. The story was finished. However, another incident took place between the Prophet ﷺ and his wives, and that shows they're human beings at the end of the day. And that teaches us how to deal with our problems. That is the household of the Prophet ﷺ. And if the problem can be contained, contain it. We all human beings at the end of the day. So Hafsa radiallahu anha and the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they had someone else competing with them now, which is Maria radiallahu anha, another wife, one of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who at the start was given as a gift, as a slave to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And at the start they say she was an amma, mulk yameen, which is the Prophet was what the right hand possessed. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had Ibrahim radiallahu anh, his son Ibrahim, from her. And when she gave birth to Ibrahim, she was set free. So Maria, she was also a beautiful woman. And the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to be jealous from her. Now, one day when it was the turn of Hafsa, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spent that day with Maria. And another narration said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is actually, when Hafsa wasn't in the house, Hafsa came and she found that Maria was actually in her house. So she became very upset with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet told her, if I do not go to Maria again, will you be satisfied? Hafsa said yes. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, okay, I will not do it, I'll not go to Maria again, but keep this as a secret between me and you, and do not tell anyone. Now Hafsa, she went and told her best friend Aisha radiallahu anha straight away. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that Hafsa told Aisha, and the news started to spread between the wives. So they exposed the secret of the Prophet ﷺ. And that is one of the narrations for the tafsir of this ayah in Surah Al-Tahrim, where Allah says, وَإِذْ أَسَرَّ النَّبِيُّ إِلَىٰ بَعْضِ أَزْوَاجِهِ حَدِيثًا فَلَمَّا نَبَّأَتْ بِهِ وَأَظْهَرَهُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ, until the end of the verse. So the Prophet ﷺ became very upset and did not go to any of his wives. And the news started to spread that the Prophet ﷺ divorced all his wives. And Umar says, I used to work in a place just on the outskirts of Medina. And I had a partner, me and him working in the land, in the same land. I'll work one day and he works one day. The day I'm working, he will go sit with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whatever he learns comes at the end of the day and he shares it with me. And when it's my turn to go to the Prophet and he stays to work in the land, I will go learn and I'll go back to him and I teach him everything I learned with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he said, my partner comes to me. He said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam divorced all his wives. So Umar radiallahu anhu dropped everything that was in his hands and ran to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he went to the masjid and he could not see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the masjid. And he saw all the companions sitting there upset because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was upset. So Umar was looking for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he found the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a place on top of one of the mountains near Medina or inside Medina. And the Prophet used to always to get to that place when he wants to worship on his own. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he went there, but he found that there was a person, it was like a garden, and there was a servant by the name of Rabah standing outside, stopping anyone from entering and interrupting the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam at that time, he did not want to speak to anyone, was very upset. So Umar told Rabah, go and ask the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam if I can enter and speak to him. So Rabah, he went and approached the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, told him Umar is outside, and he's seeking your permission to enter and speak to you. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not respond. So Rabah came back to Umar and told him the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is not responding. So Umar tried again and tried for the third time. So after the third time, Umar stood outside and he raised his voice and was speaking to Rabah, but he was raising his voice because he wanted the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to hear him inside. He said, Ya Rabah, tell Rasulullah that I want to come inside and speak to him, and I promise I will not speak to him about Hafsa or any of his wives. So Rabah, he went told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he stayed inside a bit longer with the Prophet. So Umar thought that the Prophet does not want to speak to him. So he was going back. As Umar was going back, Rabah calls him back and he says, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is allowing you to enter, but remember the condition. So Umar enters and he sits with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And now he wants to break the ice with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He said, Ya Rasulullah, when we were in Mecca, we had control over our women. We used to order them and they will do everything. And our women, when we were in Mecca, would not dare back chatting or speaking back to us. Now that we come to Medina, they learned from the women of Medina how to back chat and start giving us orders and start speaking back to us. Ya Rasulullah, back in Medina, we used to hit them, we used to bash them, and back in Mecca, and look at them, what happened in Medina. So the Prophet ﷺ started laughing. So Umar knew that now he started to break the ice. Said, Ya Rasulullah, do not be upset about the women. If you want to get married to other women, Ya Rasulullah. Find other women, Ya Rasulullah, better. But Ya Rasulullah, did you divorce your wives? So the Prophet ﷺ said, no, Ya Umar, I did not divorce my wives. So Umar started doing takbir. And the Sahaba outside, they heard Umar doing takbir. And they started doing takbir with Umar. And then the Prophet ﷺ, and then Umar radiallahu said, Ya Rasulullah, did you divorce Hafsa? He said, no. Did you divorce any of your wives? The Prophet ﷺ said, no. Then Umar radiallahu anhu said, Ya Rasulullah, if you want me to discipline Hafsa for you, I will discipline her for you. The Prophet ﷺ said, Ya Umar, it is only a small matter, and I have not divorced my wives. Now, of course, this incident happened before the incident where the Prophet ﷺ actually divorced Hafsa, and then he was ordered to return her. Hafsa radiallahu anha was described to be ibnatu abiha, the daughter of her father. What does that mean? That she had the character and the strength and the intelligence of her father, Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu. And she used to always have discussions with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. I would always request the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to explain his sayings, his ahadith, and to explain the ayat of the Quran to her. And one day, Umar radiallahu anhu was talking to one of his wives, and she decided to discuss it with him further. She said, why are you having a discussion with me further? Umar doesn't muck around. Said, don't discuss it with me. Said, how can you stop me from discussing something with you when even your own daughter is discussing things with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? When the Prophet is telling her something, she will discuss it with him. She wouldn't just agree straight away. He said, doesn't my daughter do that? She said, yes. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he went straight away to his daughter Hafsa. Said, is it true that you do that and you discuss things and you have, if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam orders you to do something, you discuss it with him further? She said, yes. He said, don't do it. He said, but all his wives do, and Aisha does that. He said, you are not like Aisha, and do not do something that will make the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam upset with you. So Umar would always want to be his daughter, obedient to her husband. Who's her husband? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Same as Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, as I mentioned last week, when he walked into the house of his daughter Aisha once, and he heard Aisha screaming at the Prophet, and he wanted to hit her, and she hid behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's their love. That's their love. Now a lot of people will say, well, if my daughter was married to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I'll do the same thing. Well, that's not true. The scholars say the hardest time, two times, do not wish that you have witnessed or you witnessed those times. The first time was the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because Allah knows if you would be able, or if you were able to handle the hardship and the persecution that the companions radiallahu anhum were going through. And another time, do not wish that you witness, is the time of the Dajjal. So Hafsa radiallahu anha was a very smart woman, and she was one of the few women that she knew how to write at that time. And that's what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of the reasons he chose his wives like Aisha and Hafsa, because they were smart, because they were young, and when you're young you can absorb, you can learn, so they can teach the companions after him. And also, if you look at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the four khulafa that were after him, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had that relationship of the musahara, which is being either married to someone's daughter or someone marrying you, getting married, someone being married to your daughter. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was married to the daughter of Abu Bakr, and was married to the daughter of Umar. And then the other two khulafa after that, Uthman and Ali, they were married to the daughters of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Why? Because they are the four khulafa who led the Ummah after the Prophet, and they needed to have that close relationship with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, so they can learn how to lead the Ummah after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now Hafsa, it is enough honor for her, and to show again the enemies of Islam who accuse Islam of oppressing women, to show the status of women in Islam, it is enough honor for her to be known as Harisatul Quran, the guardian of the Quran. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam passed away, the Quran was not compiled together yet. It was memorized either in the hearts of the companions, or written on wood or rocks or leather. And Umar radiallahu anhu approached Abu Bakr and suggested to Abu Bakr to compile the Quran in one mushaf, and Zayd ibn Thabit was given the duty of compiling the Quran in one mushaf, instead of just being written on the rocks and leather and wood, to compile it in one book, in the mushaf. And that mushaf stayed with Umar, with Abu Bakr. When Abu Bakr passed away, that mushaf was passed on to Umar. And when Umar passed away, where was that mushaf kept? It was kept in the house of Hafsa radiallahu anha. The Quran, our guidance, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first Quran that was compiled together, that was kept in the house of Hafsa radiallahu anha. So that shows the strength and the power and the respect of women in Islam, and how they have great status, and how they carry great responsibility. And when Uthman radiallahu anhu sent the masahif, wrote the mushaf on the qira'ah of Quraysh, in the dialect of Quraysh, on the Ahraf of Quraysh, and he sent a copy of the Mus'haf to each state, who did he refer to? He went and he seeked permission from Hafsa radiallahu anha to give him the Mus'haf that she has, so Uthman radiallahu anha can make copies of those Mus'haf and sent it to the other Muslim states. And then he returned this Mus'haf to Hafsa and was ordered anything else that was written from the Quran other than that to be burnt. And a lot of people say Uthman burnt the Musahif. Uthman did not burn the Musahif. But Uthman, at his time, the Muslim state started to expand, and people from non-Arab started to enter Islam and speak in the Quran in their own way, in a non-Arab way, and making a lot of mistakes. So Uthman radiallahu anhu wanted to make sure that the Quran is being spoken what? According to the language of Quraysh, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is from Quraysh. And we know the Arab tribes had different types of qira'at. And now if you look into the Quran, we have the 10 qira'at. And that's another topic, inshallah, one day we can cover. So Hafsa radiallahu anha, she was a strong woman. She was from the fuqaha. She was also a very knowledgeable woman. That her own brother, Abdullah ibn Umar, one of the most knowledgeable companions, used to go back and learn from Hafsa radiallahu anha. Hafsa radiallahu anha had that strong relationship with Aisha until Hafsa radiallahu anha passed away. Hafsa died in the 45th year of Hijrah, and many of the companions prayed on her and she was buried by her brothers and by her nephews. Once again, I declare my love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by declaring my love to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I declare my love to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by declaring my love to the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And declaring my love to the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I declare my enmity and hatred to those who hate the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and to those who hate the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Subhanak Allahumma bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.
Be informed, SMS your name to 0406 000 UMA.